thank you very much for inviting me to this event. It's a pleasure for me to be in the Big Things conference. My name is Roberto Díaz. I'm the head of the Artificial Intelligence and Deep Learning Department in Trilogic. And I'm also adjunct professor in the University Carlos III in Madrid in the Department of Signal Theory and Communications. The title of this talk is Machine Learning for Federated Privacy-Preserving Scenarios. And I'm going to talk about how to train machine learning models using data from different data owners with no information leakage. And I'm going to explain some possible dangers associated with data sharing and some mechanisms to mitigate them. Well, I suppose most of you are familiar with the term machine learning. It's a very disruptive technology, and it combines two different concepts. On the one side, humans learn from their past experience, and on the other side, computers solve tasks following the instructions in their source code. Machine learning combines and starting from a data set composed by historical records, we can create predictive models that learn the rules to solve a specific task. Well, the importance of data sharing. In the past two decades, machine learning has evolved a lot, mainly with the arrival of deep learning, that is a family of algorithms that can achieve an accuracy even superior to human beings to solve many different tasks. But to use these kind of algorithms, we need a large amount of data. So, well, to solve a complex task, we need a complex model. And to train a complex model, we need a large amount of data. And this is a barrier for many companies because it's very hard to obtain a data set large enough to solve a task. When we don't have enough training data, algorithms tend to generalize in a wrong way for unseen data and achieve poor accuracy. This problem is called overfitting, and the first solution is obvious, more training data. But in many situations, this is not possible because maybe data arrive with time, and we cannot speed up that process. In other cases, data must be correctly annotated by humans, and this is very expensive if we need to collect millions of data. So another alternative is data sharing. Maybe we can find different companies that want to solve the same task, and they can combine their respective data sets. As Peter Norbeck, the director of Google Research said, we don't have better algorithms, we just have more data. Well, this can be applied to many different industries. For example, in the healthcare sector, if we combine the medical records of different hospitals, we can obtain better accuracy in the predictive models to detect some diseases. And another example is manufacturing. Imagine that I produce robotic arms, and I sell them to different manufacturing cars companies. If I can collect the data from their production, I can train models for predictive maintenance in order to predict in advance when a robotic arm is going to fail. But once we have different companies that want to cooperate, we need to face many different barriers. Legal barriers, well, in Europe, the GDPR is very restrictive, and there is a lot of legislation about where data must reside and where must be processed. Other barrier is data ownership. Imagine that I have been collecting a data set for several years, working on it, annotating it, and digital information can be copied very easily. If I give my data set to another partner, I'm afraid, because if someone copy it and distribute it, I suddenly lose all the value of my company. We have also data confidentiality. In the example I gave you about the robotic arm, if a lot of companies give me the data set from their robotic arms, this can reveal industrial secrets, because I know how many cars they produce of every model, every time. And this is a concern for in many industries. We have also personal information leakage. Personal information can produce very high personal damage. Imagine that suddenly all your medical records are open and everybody knows about that sexually transmitted infection that you got after a crazy night. So these are not the only obstacles. We have data trustworthiness, because I know how I collected my data and how I annotated it. But I don't know what the other partners did. So maybe I don't trust in the quality of their data set. Another obstacle is data value. Imagine that I pay for a data set, but I don't want to pay if I don't know what will be the accuracy of my predictive model, because what I want is a predictive model, not the data itself. And we have also adversarial attacks. I will explain them at the end of this talk, but I can receive a data set that can produce a backdoor in a neural network after the training. Well, I'm going to tell about this project, Musketeer. Musketeer, Horizon 2020 is a European framework for research and innovation, and they provide grants for many research projects. This project received a grant from the European Union, and there are several companies working on it. We have companies, we have universities, the UC3M in Madrid, Imperial College in London, big companies such as IBM in Ireland, German companies, Italian from Greece, and we are working together to build this platform. Well, this is the basic architecture. We have a central node in the cloud that orchestrates the training of an algorithm, and we have a data owner side that must be executed in the installations of every data owner. The platform contains different privacy operation modes. Now I'm going to tell you those ones based on federated machine learning. And to start, I'm going to explain how to implement a gradient descent algorithm over different privacy operation modes. Well, when we train a machine learning algorithm, we want to optimize a cost function. And gradient descent is an optimization algorithm that finds the minima of a function by evaluating the gradient in different points and moving and updating the model in order to move to the opposite way to the gradient. In some iterations, we are reaching the minima, and it is based on the average of gradients. Well, the first privacy operation mode of Musketeer is federated machine learning. It's a concept introduced by Google 2 or 3 years ago. And it's a training schema where data never leave the installations of every data owner. So in that way, we don't have any information leakage. It's a collaborative training where at the end, every data owner has a copy of the predictive model. How it works? Well, imagine this schema. one central node that can be allocated in the cloud or whatever, really. And three different data owners that can be three different hospitals, for example, with different medical records. And I want to create a predictive model. So the first step is the initialization. The central node initializes a neural network with random weights. And it sends a copy of the neural network to each one of the data owners. Now, every data owner has a copy of the neural network, and it loads some training data. It performs an optimization step, and we obtain the gradients of this batch of data. After that, every data owner sends back the gradients to the central node. Well, we have a collection of gradients, and we can update the neural network using gradient descent. Now we have a new neural network with some knowledge that we can send back to the data owners again to repeat the process. So this is an iterative process where the central node sends the neural network to every data owner and receive gradients. Send the neural network and receive gradients. And after some iterations, we train the neural network. Well, we have another privacy operation mode. It's federated with homomorphic encryption. It's similar to the previous one, but imagine that I have a company with three different buildings, and the orchestrator is some cloud provider. Maybe I don't want a copy of my predictive model in the cloud, because I just want to keep it and only the data owners could have a copy. So we are going to use homomorphic encryption. Well, to know what is homomorphic encryption, we need to know first what is asymmetric encryption. In asymmetric encryption, that is used in many communications, I can create two different keys, a public key and a private key. Having the public key, I cannot deduce the private key. The public key is to encrypt data. The private key is to decrypt data. So I can share the public key with everyone, and everyone can encrypt data, send it to me, and I can decrypt it using the private key. Homomorphic encryption is a specific case of asymmetric encryption with some mathematical properties. For example, in the Payeer crypto system, if I receive two different encrypted data, I can add them, and I obtain an encrypted result. So there is another operation, it's a product by scalar, that we can also realize, perform in the encrypted domain. It's not too much, but those are the only operations that we need for gradient descent. So how does it work? Well, the initial setup is the same. We initialize the neural network with random numbers, and after that, every data owner has a copy of the private key, and every node has a copy of the public key. So the central node doesn't have a private key, so he never can decrypt data. The central node initializes the neural network and encrypts it, and send to every data owner in an encrypted way. Every data owner has a copy of the private key, so they can decrypt the neural network, and after that, obtain some gradients in the same way than in the previous operation mode. After that, every data owner encrypts the gradients and sends back to the central node. The central node now has gradients but are encrypted. But to update the neural network, we have the addition and product by scalar, so I can update my neural network in the encrypted domain. But I cannot decrypt it. Okay, so after some iterations, as in the previous use case, sending the neural network and receiving gradients, I finally train my neural network, and the central node can never see the weights and the values of the predictive model. The third privacy operation mode is federated with proxy re-encryption. In the previous operation mode, every data owner must have the private key. It's a good schema from different buildings of the same company, but imagine different companies that want to cooperate. Maybe there's no a secure way to share a private key. Okay? In this schema, every node has a different private and public key. Every node knows the public key of the other's nodes. And in proxy re-encryption, we can create mechanisms to translate data from an encrypted domain into another. Well, we must first interchange some information. And using it, we can translate from data encrypted from one data owner into encrypted information for another data owner. Well, we initialize here again the neural network, and we encrypt it for the first data owner. The first data owner performs a training and update the neural network locally and send back to the central node, encrypted. The central node receives an encrypted neural network, but he knows how to translate an encrypted neural network from the first data owner into an encrypted neural network for the second data owner. So it translates the neural network and send the neural network to the next data owner. The second data owner has to do the same. He has the private key to decrypt the neural network. He obtained the gradients. He performed a gradient descent step. And he can send back the neural network to the central node. Now, we need to repeat this operation, and we must translate from encrypted data of the second data owner into encrypted data for the third data owner. Now, the third one, do the same. Okay, we download the neural network, we decrypt it, we obtain gradients, we update the neural network, and we send back to the central node. And the difference with the previous training schemas is in the first and second privacy operation mode, every data owner works in parallel, and in this one is a sequential training. Well, a comparative table, as we increase the number in the privacy operation mode, we increase the privacy, but it also has an increase in the communications and mainly in the computational cost, because the operations to encrypt and decrypt data has a high computational cost. Well, the storage increases a little bit, but that's not a problem. In Musketeer, we are also developing more privacy operation schemas. Some of them are based on secure multi-party computation, where data can be moved to the cloud, but encrypted. But these operation modes are out of the scope of this talk. You can find it in some papers in the official webpage of the project. Well, dangers in federated environments. In recent years, there has been a huge proliferation and sophistication of attacks, especially focused on predictive models. A predictive model is one of the weakest points in the security chain. Why? Because maybe there is a backdoor inside of a neural network, and it's almost impossible to detect it, analyzing the weights of the neural network. We can find two different families of attacks. The first one is evasion attack. They are attacks oriented to cheat a predictive model already trained. They are designed to create a new training data, a new data, or to modify a data a little bit in order to send it to a predictive model, and the predictive model process and classify the data in a wrong way. The second family of attacks are poisoning attacks, that are attacks oriented to slightly modify a data set with two different goals. The first goal is to obtain a model with a poor accuracy, but we can also modify a training data in order to introduce a backdoor inside a predictive model. Let's see some examples. This is a road. This is a picture. Every human being can understand what there is inside. We have different vehicles, the road, trees. And if we process this picture using a segmentation network, for example, a SegNet, it must be capable to detect the different objects in the picture. This is the output of the neural network. In blue, we can see the vehicles. In red, persons. We can see the road, the traffic lights, the trees. But what is an evasion attack? If we slightly modify this image, this noise is very high, but we can introduce a noise that human beings cannot see. Here, we can still detect every object in the picture, but this is what the neural network see right now. The neural network process the image, and the result is absolutely nothing. So this is an example of evasion attack. Here you have more examples. Some attacks produce a noise that looks like a random white noise. To create this kind of attack, we need a copy of the neural network, and we need to analyze the gradients when we process one picture. And in this example, given the picture of the panda, we can add a really small noise, and the neural network classify the panda as a gibbon. The second one is with adversarial noise. We don't need a copy of the weights of the neural network. We can perform this attack as a black box optimization. Just looking input and outputs, we can design a noise that he doesn't look like as white noise. It has a kind of texture. And here, a bus is classified as an ostrich. Well, those examples in over a paper are nice, but now some recent attacks have been performed on a realist scenario. Look at this one. It was done by Chinese researchers. Here, sending some small information to the sensor of a self-driving car produce a bad effect, and the self-driving car doesn't know what there is in front of the car. Obviously, it's extremely dangerous. Here, you have another example made by Chinese researchers. So I think the Chinese government is investing a lot of money in this field. Here we have a more dangerous attack, because using an evasion attack, they discover how to put three small stickers on the road, and a Tesla car, a self-driving car, Tesla Model S, I think, move to the wrong lane of the road. So imagine how powerful could be this kind of cyber attacks. These were evasion attacks. And we also have poisoning attacks. In a poisoning attack, what we want is to create training data in order to produce a predictive model with bad accuracy or with a backdoor. An example of using bad training data. This was T-Tweets. It was the chatbot designed by Microsoft 2 or 3 years ago. They trained the chatbot, and it was very nice at the beginning. You can see hello world, nice sentences. And he started to interact with Twitter users, learning from their sentences. And after only 16 hours, well, the chatbot wasn't very nice at all. And these examples were the most political correct ones that I found. There are much worse messages. And now we have algorithms to directly create poisoning attacks. It's a bi-level optimization problem where we have a malicious goal, but we need to also keep the accuracy of the model on the test set. Well, how to mitigate these attacks? Well, in a federated schema, we have different data owners, but some of them can be malicious. So this is a good scenario for poisoning attacks, because traditionally, when you have all your data in the cloud, to avoid data poisoning attacks, you only needed traditional cybersecurity to control the access to your data lake. But now, you are not using only your data. You are using data that come from the outside, and you don't have any control over them. So a backdoor is a strategy to perform, for example, an evasion attack after the training. Here in this example, we can train a neural network to classify different traffic signals. But a backdoor could be an attack where when you, for example, you can put a sticker on a traffic signal, and the neural network always recognizes the signal as a speed limit sign. So in this case, that the original traffic signal is a stop is very dangerous. We have two strategies to create this kind of backdoors. The first one is with poisoning data sets, and the second one is with a direct manipulation of the weights in the predictive model. How we can mitigate this kind of attacks? For example, for evasion attacks, you saw that they were based on adding noise in the data. One strategy is to include in our data set data with this kind of noise. We can mitigate this kind of attacks, but it's impossible to avoid them at all. Another way to mitigate the effects is to use the Occam razor principle when we have different models that achieve the same accuracy. We need to keep the simpler model, because in simple predicting models, it's very difficult to find a specific noise to create an evasion attack. In data poisoning attacks, in a federated schema, you saw that we were receiving gradients from the different data owners. What we need to implement here is an outlier or anomaly detection in the weights or the gradients received by the different data owners. If we have 100 data owners and the weights received by one of them are very different from the others, then we can recognize that is an attack. Obviously, if we have a lot of people working against us, it's impossible to detect a data poisoning attack. This is our video in YouTube. We are going to release the first version of Musketeer in a few months, and we are going to organize a hackathon, so you can pay attention on Twitter and take part in the hackathon. And to finish, this is Trilogic, my company. We provide services to our clients, and we also take part in many research projects in order to learn the state of art in machine learning. And that's all. You have here my email address. If you have any question in the future, you can contact me. And that's all.